be pressing on. Pressing on, taken from Philippians, chapter 3, verse 14. So, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. And as I've already mentioned in the previous verse here, it's not as though we have attained anything. Okay, we have come to a knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior. We are saved, we are cleansed from all our sins. But that doesn't make us as though perfect Christians. No one is perfect and complete. Our walk with the Lord takes effort going forward. And if you look at Philippians chapter 3 and verse 13, it says, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are," where? "Before." So where do our eyes need to be fixed? Our eyes need to be fixed forward, not backward. We don't need to dwell on the past, the things that have happened in the past. We need to be looking towards the future. Looking where Christ is leading us as individuals, where Christ is leading us as a family, where Christ is leading us as a church. We need to be looking to Him and asking Him to lead and guide us. Not saying, "Lord, this is what I want to do with my life this year. But Lord, what will You have me do?" Romans 12:1. Presenting ourselves as a living sacrifice. Here am I, Lord, use me. Here am I, Lord, use me. And so pressing on during trials, times of hardship. There will be times of hardship through 2017. But we need to press on through those barriers. Breaking through those barriers. There will be stumbling blocks. I can assure you that Satan will put stumbling blocks before your feet. I can assure you of that. There will be some trial. There will be some tribulation in your life this year. Whatever that may be, I don't know. I don't know what that will be. However, we know that there will be trials and tribulations. And it's at that time we need to be thinking about pressing on through that barrier and moving on with the Lord. An effort and push towards that finish line. Making a commitment. Making a commitment. When we get married, we expect our wives or our husbands to make a commitment to the marriage. To put an effort into a marriage. We expect the church people that are members of the congregation to put an effort and to work in the church. We would expect them to make a commitment to serving and be of use and of service for the Lord. And it should be a lifetime theme and not just a 2017 theme. Should be a lifetime theme. We should always have that vision to push on through. In a race, and I don't know if you've been in a race, athletics race, and sometimes your legs go faster, you know, your mind goes faster than what your legs can go. And so you end up tumbling and things like that. But if you're in a race, and years ago, I used to be quite good. Years ago, not so good now. I used to be fast. At Linwood High School, I used to always be first and represent the school at QE2. And then the QE2 track was out, and so Mum and Dad bought me the 6mm running shoes with the metal tags that come with that, because you couldn't use the grass ones because they were too long. And so we used the 6mm ones, and I used to win the races, but I didn't do any good against other schools. However, I was pretty fast, and when you're behind and you want to win, and you see that finish line approaching, you really, really have to push hard, dig deep and push on. And you fight on. So do you give up and say, oh, well, I'm behind now, I might as well give up? Or do you push on? And obviously, you push on. If there is no response, now this is a key thing here. If there's no response in presenting the gospel of Jesus Christ, do we give up or fight on? We present the gospel. Now we've just had the South Island Blitz. There's been no reports of anyone being saved. There's been reports of tracts, 3,000 odd tracts being given out, and there's been preaching, and there's been good conversations had with different people, which is wonderful. But there's been no response. Does that mean that, okay, there's been no response, we just give up? What would your Savior want you to do? What would God want you to do? If there's no response, does He say, well, just give up? Although, when we read in Scripture, the Great Commission is to go out into all the world and preach the gospel until no one receives it any longer, or until you've just exhausted your efforts, or you've exhausted your contacts, or do you just keep on going? You have to keep on fighting through the barrier of apathy of the world. Our task is to sow the seed. And if there's no response, that doesn't mean to say we stop. We continue doing that. Just like in a race. If you really want to win, you will push on. You will press on. You'll dig deep. You'll find that. So there needs to be a vision, or else the people perish. We need to know where we're going. We need to know where we're going. What is the vision for preaching the gospel? What is the vision for preaching the gospel? It's a simple question, simple answer. Quite clearly, is for people to get saved. Okay? The prize will be various, and we're going to look at 2 Corinthians. Let's turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Beginning at verse 10. So when the Bible says pressing on in Philippians chapter 3 verse 14 to a prize, what is that prize? What is that prize? Well, if we look at verses 10 through to 11, we know that we will stand before the Lord and give account of the effort that you have made. Now remember, these are individual. As individuals, you will stand before God and give your commitment, your response to the commitment you've made to the great love that He gave us on the cross. So verse 10 says, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad." So guess what? The prize can be good, or the prize can be bad. Verse 11, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, and I wonder if how many people actually read that and understand that. When you stand before a holy God, who do we think God is, and who do you think you are? Read that word, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord. We persuade men, but we are made manifest unto God, and I trust also are made manifest in your consciences. The terror of the Lord. We are all going to have to give account before God. So therefore, press on. Dig deep. Move on. Break through those barriers, the apathy barrier. And I'm just not saying that anybody's apathetic here. We need to make a commitment. We know the terror of the Lord. Now, our church has a vision. And we raise that at the AGM. So as a church, we're closing in on our short-term vision. Now, some of the things we haven't achieved and some things we have still working on and haven't achieved, does that mean that we need to give up on our vision? No. We need to continue to push through those things. We've had setbacks. We've had people come. We've had people go. Families come. Families go. People who are coming but don't make a commitment. We have people who come and they do make a commitment. We need to have a vision or we will perish. We need to know where we're going. We need to know where we're going this year. Where are we heading as a church? Where are you heading individually with the Lord? As a family. Fathers, where are you taking your family this year with the Lord? As a church, we try to put things in place so that the children can grow and be nurtured in the Lord. Okay, we have Sunday school, we've got More Than Conquerors, we've got music, we've got things that will encourage them and grow them. And that's part of the vision that we have. But we also need to ensure, as personally, where am I going? Where am I going? It's time to press on. Pressing forward, pushing on. It may seem like we are swimming against a swiftly flowing current. I'm not saying jump in the river, in the swiftly flowing river, but it feels like that sometimes. Feels like that. We're trying to move on. And yet, we don't see the results, but that doesn't mean to say we need to stop. We move on, we take two steps forward, and then all of a sudden something comes along and we have to take one step back. Well, we need to press on, we need to move on. We cannot, we must not give up. We must not give up. Hold the fort, for I am coming, Jesus signals still. That's a hymn that we often sing. And you know, wave the answer back to heaven in the chorus. We wave our Bibles. Wave the answer back to heaven. By thy grace we will. We need to push on. We need to push on. Now notice when we look at the, I've kept the verse up here through the slides. Notice the word, let's go back to Philippians. And it's an opportunity for you to highlight. If you're taking notes, make sure you put this little mark here. I. It's a personal one. It's not talking about the church. It's not talking about all of Christendom. It's not talking about my family. It's not talking about the person next door to me or dependent on the person next door to me who is sitting next to me. I. So let's look at ourselves between you and the Lord. I press on. I'm pressing on. So Paul says, I press toward the mark of the prize for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. I. It's a personal effort. So it's regardless of what others do. If the other people are backsliding, moving away, not doing the things that you would expect them to do, well, they're not doing it. Isn't that the kids' thing? Go tidy your room. Well, Johnny's room is not tidy. So why should my room be? I will battle on. I am going to be faithful to the Lord. Even though maybe my husband, my wife, my uncle, my auntie, my mother, my father, whoever, isn't, I will press on. I will do my best and give my best for the Master. And even though I might get disillusioned, and yes, if we're not encouraged, and if we see people around us that are not giving their best or pushing on, I might get disillusioned. And a pastor often gets disillusioned because we know where we should be going, but it's always difficult to drag people with him. And pushing on. You know, there's the driving the sheep. Sometimes you have to drive. And once the sheep are moving, then you can move to the front and then they can follow you. But sometimes you've got to go around the back and send the dogs. Call the deacons. Go and sort them out. And then pushing on. But sometimes you will get disillusioned. And this year might be a year where you may find something that happens in your life, something that happens in the church, and you are disillusioned. But of course, you should never be put off by others. You should need to be pressing on to the mark. And I will do my best for the Master. Forget about what others are doing. I. Guess who has to give account at the judgment seat of Christ anyway?
I.
Myself. So forget about what others are doing and do your best. Do your best. Push on, press on until I reach the finish line. Don't let the will of the flesh get in the way. Because the flesh is pretty powerful. The mind is willing, the flesh is weak, but we tend to give in to the flesh. You know what the right thing is to do, the right thing to do. You all know that. I mean, I don't have to tell you what the right thing is to do. The right thing to do. You all know that. But the flesh will get in the way. The flesh will get in the way. This was Eve's problem. So in Genesis chapter 3, we won't go there. Eve was blaming Satan. We can blame Satan and say, well, I can't be doing my best because Satan keeps on buffeting me. What do you need to say? Get thee behind me, Satan. Step over those stumbling blocks. Move around those stumbling blocks. Let's go to Psalm 73. And I suppose this is one of my favorite psalms in terms of the flesh, because the flesh will always be a problem, because I have to live in this flesh, I have to use this body. So let's begin at verse 1. Might as well begin at verse 1. Truly God is good to Israel, even to such as are of a clean heart. So we can make that and turn that into a Christian. I know that that's not sort of dispensational, but God is good to us. Amen? He has saved us. He died on the cross for us. He paid the penalty for sin for us. He has got a vision for us. And so even to such as are of a clean heart, if you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, then you are and should have a clean heart. But let's continue on reading the Psalm of Asaph and think about the terms of the flesh here. But as for me, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well nigh slipped. For I was envious at the foolish. when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. For there was no bands in their death, but their strength is firm. And we often see that. We say, well, that person is a Christian, and yet they are suffering with cancer. They're suffering through life with sicknesses and things. And here is this person who is unsaved, and yet they're perfectly healthy, they're strong, they have this long life. And this is exactly what Asaph was looking at, seeing these people and saying, well, these people are a clean heart and yet they're suffering. And yet those people who are not saved, they are, well, healthy. There are no bands in their death, but their strength is firm. Therefore pride compasseth them about as a chain. Violence covereth them as a garment. In other words, they don't need God. They think they don't need God. And pride comes. Pride comes. Their eyes stand out with fatness. They have everything. They have more than their heart could wish. And these are the unsaved people. Their eyes stand out with fatness. They have more than their heart could wish. In verse 8, they are corrupt. They speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak loftily. They don't have no worries about oppressing the poor. They're very prideful. They speak loftily. They have aplomb in their mouth. You know? They set their mouth against the heavens. And their tongue walketh through the earth. Their tongue walketh through the earth. It's like going through the gutter. Using bad language. But Asaph is looking in the flesh. He's looking at these people who are unsaved, and he's looking at them in the flesh. In the flesh. Verse 12. Behold, these are the ungodly who prosper in the world. They increase in riches. Verily, I have cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands in innocency. Basically, he's saying, why am I a Christian? I've trusted Christ as death on the cross of Calvary, as an atonement for my sins. I've washed my heart in vain because look at all these people who are ungodly and yet they live a life, a lavish life. They live a life which is far better than what I could ever live. They have more than their heart could wish. They have so much money. They have lovely houses. All these things. They have everything that they would want. Verily, verse 13, verily I have cleansed my heart in vain and washed my hands in innocency. For all the day long have I been plagued and chastened every morning. If I say I will speak thus, behold, I should offend against the generation of my children. Isn't that just the case? You know, I'm going to do a good deed and all of a sudden that good deed falls back on you and people say bad things about you. Or you say something to try to say a nice word to someone and it ends up being bouncing back and being something dreadful and you've made yourself an enemy. Verse 15, if I say I will speak thus, behold, I should offend against the generation of thy children. When I thought to know this, it was too painful for me. Verse 17, until I went into the sanctuary of God, then understood I their end. Surely thou did set them in slippery places. Thou castest them down into destruction. Cast them down into hell. Verse 19. How are they brought into desolation? As in a moment. They are utterly consumed with terrors. The moment they die and open their eyes in hell, they are consumed with terrors. They're afraid. They're in flames. Yes, so we can in this world look at others and say, oh, look, they're ungodly, they're unsaved, and yet look at the lovely life there. That's the flesh speaking. When I come into the house of the Lord, then I know their end. When I come into the house of the Lord and I know my end, the wage of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Wow. So the flesh may get in the way, but we don't want the flesh to get in the way. We don't want to look at others and say, look what they're doing. What am I doing? We need to press on. So let's let the Lord encourage our hearts. So let's just go through a few verses and then we'll finish this morning and we'll pick it up again next week. So about four passages we'll look at. So 2 Corinthians again. We've already looked at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and down to verse 16. For all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God. So let's break this verse down a little bit. For all things, we know Romans 8:28, all things work together for good to them that love God, to them that are called according to his purpose. Okay? Everything that happens in your life, everything that will happen this year in your life, whatever that may be. For all things are for your sake. When God brings trials and tribulations in your life, it is for your betterment. It is for your good. And because of that, we should have the power and the strength, because he will never leave us nor forsake us, to push through those barriers. Press on. Pressing on. For all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God. We give God the glory. So the trial and the tribulations, as well as the good things, we give God the glory for. Because it is for our good that we go through these things. We come out better. Job says, because when I've been tried, I come through as gold. Gold. And Job was a man to speak about trials and tribulations. We've had nothing. It may feel like a huge trial, tribulation, but put yourself in Job's shoes. Let's turn to Galatians. Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. Once again, let him that is taught in the word, are you taught in the word? You'll notice that in the church bulletin, there's going to be a new feature, or there is already started this week, a new feature to encourage you to study God's word, not merely to read it through, and you've got your reading plan for the year, but to study it. And so I'm going to put some questions. Well, actually, Crystal's going to, I'll give her the questions. She's going to put it in the notices. But for you to do some research if you need to. To study. Okay, let him that is taught in the word. You need to be taught. We need to be taught in the word. And then, of course, communicate unto him that teacheth in all good things. Communicate back to me the good things that the Lord is doing in your life. What you've learned from the scriptures. What is God telling you? What's God teaching you? Through a trial? What's he teaching you through a trial? Through a tribulation? What is he preparing you for? There may be some trial or tribulation in the months to come. Year to come. Years to come. And yet the Lord is preparing you to be able to take that trial. There's no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But it feels pretty tough and pretty hard when you go through it. And so he prepares you for that. Luke 18. So Matthew, Mark, Luke. So turn back left. Luke 18. Studying the scriptures. Reading the scriptures is one thing. Focusing on the Lord. Luke 18. And he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to what? Pray. And not to faint. We need to press on in prayer. Pressing on. It's not just something that we do as last resort. It's the first thing we should do. And really, God says that men ought how many times to pray? Always to pray. Always. Pray without ceasing. Always to pray. And not to faint. God wants to encourage you to keep on keeping on. Finally, Isaiah chapter 40. Isaiah 40, verse 31. And some people have this as a plaque in their homes. It says there, Isaiah 40, verse 31, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. And they shall walk and not faint. So throughout this year, I want us individually, personally, think about pressing on for the Lord. Fathers, mothers, same thing for your family. Where are you heading with your family? Where are you going with your family? What are you teaching your family? What's God teaching you himself, personally? Where are we going as a church? We have a vision. I think what I'll do is I'll put it in the newsletter next week so we can be refreshed about where we're going as a church. Pushing on, pressing on. We've had setbacks, labourers that have left, possible labourers that never stayed. But that doesn't mean to say we just give up, throw everything, say, oh, that's it. Press on. Press on. Oh, I haven't had any result from letterboxing or tracting or going out to the square or whatever, so therefore we give up. No, we press on. press on. We want to be found worthy. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. That's what I want to hear. When I stand before God, I want to hear him say, thou good and well-serving servant. I know I could do more. Who will go with me? As a church, as individuals. But I will move on. I will press on. Let's close in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you, Father, for the witness of Paul. And Father, that you allowed that to enter into Scripture. Father, it's your heart for us to press on. Father, we do pray that as we've seen a few weeks ago, we are the clay, you are the potter. And Father, we do pray that as a vessel which has been formed by you, whatever that may be, for we're all being given different talents, Father, that we would indeed press on. Father, we do pray and thank you first and foremost for the Lord Jesus Christ, who died on the cross. Our first step, our baby step. Father, we do pray that as we grow in grace, as we grow in the knowledge of the Lord, as we grow being admonished, being chastened by you, Lord, Father, being shaped, being used, those rough edges that are taken off, being fired in the kiln. Father, we do pray that we would come forth as gold. We do pray, Father, we would be used by you this year. In fact, it should be a life verse. And Father, we do pray that we would apply that to our lives, that we would indeed be pressing on for that great prize. What is man that thou art mindful of him, says the psalmist. Who do we think we are? Father, we do thank you that we are the children of God. We thank you, Lord, for eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. We now present our life before you, Lord. And we do pray that we may have the strength, the fortitude, to be able to dig deep and press on, regardless of what's going on around us. I know, Lord, that I will stand before you personally. My name will be called out. And I will make my way before the Bema seat, before the judgment seat of Christ. And Father, I do pray that I would hear the words, well done, the faithful servant. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. Father, we do pray, Lord, that we may indeed be found faithful. Dedicate this year, Father, to you. And we do pray that as a church, as a body of believers, as individuals, as families, we would press on in Jesus' precious name.